token sale. It was the second largest token sale ever, and now it's just jumped in. It's one of the smaller token sales. It's gotten quite a lot bigger from there. Notice I say the word token sale. I don't particularly like the term ICO. Maybe that's just from my personal experience when we did the second token sale. It was not an info. And number two is that our token is a closed use case token used in the protocol to buy and sell storage space in the network, and is not a security. So when you start going the IPO route, you know, that's a completely different thing from what we're trying to do. So kind of two points there. So I won't take too long up here speaking on the stage. I like to jump into questions fairly often and early and kind of lead from there. Who here is familiar with storage before they came here? Okay. How many own storage tokens? Raise your hand. Okay. A few. Maybe we'll get some more by the end of that. So storage is a decentralized and distributed cloud storage platform. We started in 2014 as an open source project. We thought, hey, we're gonna build the next encrypted, decentralized Dropbox. And then kind of realize, wait a minute, for years and years and years, Dropbox has stored all their data on Amazon S3. So we weren't really gonna be disruptive, just being another Dropbox-like app. And so we decided to go kind of a level deeper and be that S3 layer that stores pretty much a good majority of the world's data, and provide that to the people who actually make the decisions in cloud storage. When you buy or when you download the next cat picture sharing app, you don't care whether it goes to Amazon S3 or Google Cloud or all these other providers, you just care that the app works. So the developers are the ones that actually made those decisions on where that data goes. So we provide a layer for them to use and store the data. So we kind of made that transition from 2014 to 2015 from an open source project to a company. So the first open sale that we did was in 2014 for $500,000. When I was around pitching this idea of decentralized and distributed cloud storage to VCs, and I'm like, oh yeah, it's built on like Bitcoin and blockchain. They're like, that's used for drugs and guns, right? Yeah, no one would fund that or give me money for that. But the community and the people were happy to do that. So we were able to get our start there, realize, really useful, powerful technology, but at the end of the day, we need a more traditional structure to get this into users' hands. So founded a company in 2015 to do just that, to abstract it, to make it easy to use, to provide more tools. And so from 2015 to 2017, we built it out. And March 15th of 2017, we launched the production launch of the product, of the cloud storage platform. And started getting real users and real revenue and all those fun things that a business needs. And just after that, we did essentially our second token sale for $30 million to help grow and scale that. So that's kind of a brief overview of what storage is, who we're focusing on, and kind of the way we build it out. So that's it for me. Keep it fairly short, and just open up to questions on anything you might have around storage, or around token sales, or the ecosystem. We have
another mic right here, but I'll jump in. So you said that you were going to be a closed ecosystem. Can you elaborate a little bit about that?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
No.
Okay, I'll speak really loud. So. At the end of the day, when we're storing data on this network, we have people called farmers that rent out their hard drive space to the network. and store little bits and pieces of encrypted chunks of data. Now, let's say you're storing a cat picture on this network, and it's broken up into, you know, 40 pieces, and, you know, a cat picture is a very small amount of data. And so we might owe, what's your name over here, Christian? You know, he's storing one of those chunks 1,000%, right? And so there's no way we could do, like, let's say, an ACH transfer to you for 1,000%. That just wouldn't work. But...
does this work?
But
what we can do is we can send you essentially the storage token quickly and effectively, cheaply, for essentially storing that data over time. So it's very useful, and it's really not possible without that token aspect. There's many other components to that, but that's one of the primary mechanisms is incentivization and payment, where traditional systems just don't work.
So the container has the token with it? Container gets the piece of data. What's separate from that?
So there's separate. So he receives the data, and then we check and audit him over time, and he proved that he has the data, then we essentially send him a payment for that.
So yeah, I just wanted to ask you about transition over to, you know, when you did your second token sale, did that. When you decided to do that, what was your strategy in kind of managing your community when moving from one service to the other one? Like, did you have a strategy there about, like, how you would explain this to your users, how you transition and integrate them? Like, what was your thought process there?
Yeah, so I think it's really interesting if you look at the blog for a website and you see where we announce kind of the transition to Ethereum and the issues that we had. There's a couple of vision posts that try to, like, drag people over the finish line to that platform. Because when we started doing, thinking about migration and moving over, Ethereum was a lot smaller than it is now. That's kind of strange to say, but at the time people were still on the fence about it. We were having issues where we send transactions, we have, at last count, 40,000 farmers, like 40,000 people or nodes running on their addresses. We had a lot less back then, probably in the tens of thousands, but we had to send all these transactions out to pay these users. And we're doing that on Bitcoin. And around that time, Bitcoin was having a scaling problem. And so normally we would expect to send these transactions out, and it would take 10 minutes. It would take hours or days. We send these transactions out, and instead of paying a little tiny fee, we'd actually be paying like 20 or 30% of the transaction cost that we sent out, which is insane. And many other cases in terms of interoperability with the ecosystems and integration into our platform. So I took the view probably about 8 months ago, 9 months ago, that we needed to switch to Ethereum or some other platform other than what we were using. It took us a while to get there conceptually, but also build the process and explain that to the community. So it took a while, but we're one of the first people to do a migration cross-platform, and we actually have a bunch of people who are looking to follow that and use the same code as well. So it was a fun process.
Thank you.
Hey, can you walk us through the steps of the token sale? Probably. Hey, let's raise money to what exactly you need to do.
Yeah, so one of the things that we're really focusing on is having a working, functioning product that people can try and use before you do the token sale. A lot of people are going a different route. I think we've been able to privilege to be in this space quite a while. So I've been in the Bitcoin, blockchain, now here in space around 5 years. A lot of people have kind of had that privilege. So we had a lot of time to kind of build it out. So I think that's the first piece in terms of building out, you know, use tokens that aren't securities that are very useful to the network, to the community, and what they do.
then the second part is kind of figuring out the economics and mechanics of the token and the sale. There's a lot of stuff that goes into building an ERC-20 token, making it secure, thinking forward in terms of things you'll have to do in the future. I think third is also communicating to the community, both people who will use this token and who wants to buy this token, you know, what it is, what its value, what its use case is, how to transfer and access it. And then the fourth is, which will take a lot of time, is this logistical portion of the sale. Sales are never done once the counter stop and the money is raised. There's still a bunch of organizational stuff to do. So that's one thing that I caution anyone thinking of doing a token sale, is that it's not done when, you know, the money is raised. There's a million other things that you have to do after. I'm curious, who in here wants to do a token sale? This is a raised hand. Oh, wow. Guess that's why you're here, right? It's a lot of work.
What do you mean by that, though? Like, the final thing is not taking too deep, but I don't know, like you said, the work never stops, the logistics. Can you, like, tell us more about that?
Yeah, so the security aspects, right? You have people who had lots of tokens and was very multi-sig, and they had some issues with that. Thankfully, that they got most of that back. So security and structures is really important. Interfacing it with the traditional accounting and tax systems is also very difficult. There's almost an infinite amount of problems there that are very high priority that you have to figure out. I think also it's worth noting kind of just the time sink that some of these things are. Doing, you know, for us, you know, 18-hour days for months. Just work, sleep, just because there's so many things to do. So it's definitely probably one of the funnest times in your life, but also the most stressful. So I just caution people, okay, get lots of good rest and eat well before you do it. Get some crunching back here.
I'm just curious, was your offering a US-based offering? And you allow US investors, or did you have to say no US investors? Or
buyers? So our token sale was an annual token sale. It was not a security. So it was open to any of our purchasers except actually New York. So it should be here, right? So I hope any of you who participated in the storage token sale did outside of the state lines, please. So that's a little bit of that license. People are still kind of figuring that portion out with token sales. So a lot of people are doing inside the US structure, outside the US structure, both. It really depends on what you're trying to do.
Thanks. So given what you know now, and given what you did, what are the three or four things you would change if you had to do a token sale today?
Oh, man, that's a good question. Well, the first point is get a lot more sleep and eat a lot more food beforehand. Probably spend a lot more time essentially on the technical work, even before you think you're going to do a token sale, because that definitely takes a lot of time. Making a token on Counterparty on Bitcoin took me about an hour, just to do myself. Doing a proper ERC-20 token, the proper security and all the features that we want, took someone much, much smarter than me, many weeks, and external audits. to do. And it's the middle kind of of the token sale and building it up. So doing a lot of more work on the technicals ahead of time, even before you think you're going to do a token sale, and really understanding those tokens. Let's see. I think those are kind of the two things for our particular sale. Since we already had a token and already had kind of a functioning product and stuff, I think some of those other things might be already taken care of for us, but I think those were probably the two things. Okay.
Thank you.
Listen, real quickly, with respect to following a number of these questions, as far as your token sale, can you give us a sense of the number of amount of time it took from start to finish and also the cost? Because when you're talking about this, I assume you're bringing in outside of advisors, Argon Group, or something like that. So I'm just curious about how that worked out.
Let's see here. So, in terms of time, our token sale. So are we talking about preparatory time or the time that the token sale actually ranks?
Well, a lot, mostly preparatory, but also I'm curious, I think your token sale ranked is something month.
Yeah, so the token sale ran from 6 to 7 days.
Oh, okay,
and we raised 30 million in that time period. As far as the preparatory time, I had been kind of working on this since about December. Of last year, individually, and the team started to jump on maybe around February or so.
And the sale was what month?
The sale was in May. And the 18-hour days started probably March.
As far as cost?
Cost, I think that's a little difficult. Or bank say probably.
Well, I'm just talking about type of things.
Yeah, so there's definitely quite a lot of groups like Token Market that help us with the technicals. Point Fund will help us with some of the economics. So there's a bunch of helpful groups, but kind of their fees vary. In terms of the fees, it can be a little expensive upfront. If you're doing a large sale, in the hundreds of thousands of dollars for upfront costs. I won't say anything about the afterwards. And you have a lot of people who have done very large open sales that have spent millions of dollars and done it for numerous years to really raise like these large open sales.
So, can you give us a sense for what the token sale did when you use the community? Is this something that's out there? How does the value of the token actually help the system?
Yeah, so when we talk about the token, we don't focus too much on the spot value. We focus on the utility of the network and the use of the network to really capture this market opportunity. It's $20 to $30 billion a year cloud storage market that's growing every year. No one says I need less cloud storage. So that's what we're really focusing on capturing, which brings a lot of value to the ecosystem, the business, the token. In terms of the community, we have a lot of the community that were participants in that token sale, but also benefited from now the increased resources that we have to build out the tools that they need and want to use. That's why they're there for cloud storage. And so the more tools and things that we can build out, the better. So we spend a lot, and a lot of that, those resources go directly just into engineering. So recently we announced an integration with FileZilla, which is essentially the world's largest and most used MVP client tool for moving around large chunks of data.
Right now we have around 31,000 API users, and that FileZilla gives us access to 15 million in about a month. So kind of large integration there that's very helpful, and we have many more of that size and larger that are coming down. So those resources allow us to support into engineering to build tools and services that the community can then use for the classroom.
After your successful token sale was over, how was the process of cashing out?
That's a good question. So,
test,
very convenient.
Just like me trying to get access to my Bitcoin cash. So yeah, we actually went through this in 2014. And so we learned from this is that we had all our token sale in Bitcoin, right? And it's like up here, something like 500, maybe more. Down to, low hundreds, and it really hurt. It really hurt. Same thing happens over here, right? They were 2 months from running out of, everything mass are now so we did cash out some of our tokens and we definitely recommend that's a lot of people. You don't know where the crypto market's gonna get. We have a pretty strong edge obviously we're building our platform. We definitely recommend people get some cash, some euros, some dollars, something, that's going to be around. Because people want to be paid a salary, they want health insurance, all those things that are currently paid dollars. Get this out of here.
Thank you. I was just saying, this created this decentralized platform because of the foundation of the internet. So it's worth the biggest source of backup, so it's a nice strategy, right? So if it's an entrepreneur, you probably have a relationship that's selling and acquire. So for somebody who does an ICO, what does that essentially look like?
The tokens, there's definitely a lot of people have done that in an unkosher manner, right? The global token, abandon it or correct it. For businesses, that's more common, right? So, for example, I go out of business, and you can sell that business, right, to somebody else. For the tokens, as long as you get sufficient network effect, and use of the tokens, you can actually have a good bit of the founding team work on other things or the base team work on other things and it still exists and flourish. So for example, Satoshi's no longer around. It has sufficient network effect and a sufficient amount of people working on it that the vision and what it's trying to build out still continues even after the people are working on it. So I think that's probably one of the most important aspects is that transition or that move away from those people who are working on it happens at a point where there's enough network effect, enough use in other people to take care of the order of the vision and the architecture and the technology. So I think there's quite a few other cryptocurrencies that I end up like that about.
Just from the live stream, it's going to be going on. Why is an ICO versus a traditional funding round? Is the question.
Sure. So the question was why raise a token sale? Remember, I don't like the word ICO versus a traditional raise. So funny story. We did both. So we actually did three. So we did a token sale in 2014. Bitcoin was used for crossing guns, on the decentralized storage network. Number two is we did a equity financing conversation for the business. Raised about $3 million on that. A lot of mini VCs and angels in the space. Then we followed that up with a token sale once we had launched essentially this product. And I actually recommend both. I actually recommend doing a equity sale before you have essentially a product and still building things out. And those people will really help you focus into making something that's sustainable, that's a business that can grow. And then once you have that product launch, then doing your token sale and using that to build out the network and the product and all that. I think a lot of people are taking the other route, which is the token sale, and not doing the token. So that is my recommendation. That's the way that we've gone. And it's been very fruitful on both sides. So the community side, which really helps and supports the network, the code base, and what we're trying to build, but also the very established advisors and investors in storage labs, the business that like have seen some of the show before and can really help us avoid it.
Last question, guys.
So the question was, token holders, what are they expecting in their purchase of the tokens? And then what do you do with the proceeds raised from the tokens?
All right, so second question, what do we do with the proceeds from the sale? Like I said before, most of that goes into engineering and building the tools and the resources, the marketing, all these things that are components of the business. So for example, we have a staff of about 12 to 13, all except one coach. So most of that is just going right into engineering. In terms of the expectations from the sale, a lot of people that participated in the sale, and we have polls on this, is these are people who use cloud storage and want a more secure, fast, and private option. I mean, just raise your hand if you use cloud storage online. Like any, yeah. So that's just about it. So it's a very, very useful platform to build applications on, and people can actually use the token for that. So for example, yeah, we're building that S3 layer, right? That's where we're focusing, that underlying layer. But you can still have a Dropbox-like application on top that people can use on top of it. So again, there's a lot of people who can use that to begin with. I think that's it. We're out of time. Feel free to talk to me afterwards. I'm at Super3 on Twitter.